Okay, yeah, thank you. So this is then my last lecture in this series, and I think the last lecture of the entire subject this year. And I'm going to talk about the computation or algorithms for the computation of Jacobi symbols. And this really should be understood to apply to algebraic number fields, because that is where the real interest lies. But to begin with, let me remind you of the situation that you may be familiar with over the rational numbers. So suppose that I take P an odd prime and A an integer that is not divisible by P, then we have the Legendre symbol, the Legendre symbol A on P, and that is defined by two properties. The first is that its value is either 1 or minus 1, and secondly, modulo P, it is congruent to A to the power P minus 1 over 2 modulo P. If you square this right-hand side, then by Fermat's little theorem, you get 1 modulo P. So this is a square root of 1, and in the field mod P, you have 2 square roots of 1, and that is what the Legendre symbol is. And this is often called a quadratic symbol, because if A is congruent to a square modulo P, then the value is 1. And if A is not congruent to a square modulo P, then the value is minus 1. And from its very definition, it is perfectly straightforward to see that there is a polynomial time algorithm that on input A and P computes the symbol by repeated squarings and multiplications modulo P. All of the intermediate results should also be computed modulo P to avoid getting numbers that are too large. And in fact, there is a faster algorithm, of course, still polynomial time, to do this, and that relies on a generalization that is the Jacobi symbol. And the Jacobi symbol is defined for A and B in Z. B is positive and odd. It is composed of such primes P, and A and B are required to be co-prime. And then the Jacobi symbol is the same as the Legendre symbol if B is a prime number, and in general, you extend the definition of the symbol by multiplicativity in the lower argument. So this is a product that ranges over all primes, and then you take A on P, the Legendre symbol, and you raise it to the power, the number of factors P that occur in B, which of course for most primes will be 0. And it is good to know and clear from the definition that this depends only on the residue class of A modulo B, because this one only depends on the value of A modulo P. So if you fix B, then you can reduce A modulo B without changing the value of the symbol. You can replace A by its remainder upon division by B. And when your A is, once your A is less than B, then you can often make use of a remarkable theorem that is due to Gauss, which is the reciprocity law, which initially was stated for two prime numbers, but it is very easy to extend it to the Jacobi symbol, and that is as follows. If A and B are both positive and odd, and they are still co-prime, then there is a relation between the two symbols, A on B and B on A, and that relation is that they are equal, except if both A and B are 3 modulo 4, in which case they are actually different. So this is something that you can apply by first reducing A modulo B, then A is the smaller one. If A is also odd, you can turn the symbol around. In case you are trying to compute it, you have to keep track of this sign. If A is even, then there are a few special laws. The first is that 2 on B is equal to 1 if B is plus or minus 1 mod 8, and it is minus 1 if, in the other case, when B is plus or minus 3 modulo 8. And I did allow A to be negative here, so you also want to know what the minus 1 is, and that just depends on B modulo 4. So here you see that you have enough material for computing the symbol, essentially by means of the Euclidean algorithm. You do have to pay a little special attention to parity issues, as I pointed out. But if you look in the notes, the lecture notes written by Daan van Gent, you will see that those can be taken care of without very much effort, so that the computation of the symbol, even when the denominator is a prime number, can be done as fast as the Euclidean algorithm, which is a bit faster than an entire exponentiation. And of course, it should be pointed out that there is one way not to compute it, which is from its definition, because that would require the factorization of B into prime numbers, which is typically inaccessible at the current state of mathematics. Now, what I'm going to do in this lecture is that I will tell you how this Jacobi symbol can be extended to algebraic number fields. That turns out to be pretty straightforward, except that there will be a difference. There is already this A modulo B. In the case of algebraic number fields, this B, so to speak, the denominator, this B will not be an element. It will be an ideal of the number field. Of course, it may be a principal ideal, but that is certainly not the only interesting case. So there's already a certain asymmetry, and you really, before you have a reciprocity law like this, then you have to restrict to principal ideals, so that there is already something of a problem when you try to compute that generalized symbol in a similar manner. And of course, there's also the problem that the Euclidean algorithm that we have been using here for integers, that will in general be inapplicable to rings of algebraic integers. So that is the challenge of the lecture, how to compute the Jacobi symbol in polynomial time. And let me first give you the definitions. So I will start with replacing Z by a ring that I call R, which is an order in a number field. So that means a subring of the ring of integers. The ring of integers itself, as I pointed out earlier this week, that is really an object that in the context of algorithms better be avoided, because it is very hard to compute without something like factoring. And it is not only difficult to compute, it is also difficult to recognize. It is hard to say whether a given order is actually equal to the ring of integers of its field of fractions. If you find that surprising, then I should suggest to you just to think a little bit about the case that your number field is just a quadratic field of degree 2 over Q. Already in that case, maximal orders are hard to compute. Okay, so not necessarily maximal. We have in here an ideal, and I call it B. It plays the role of the B a moment ago. And in the case of integers, I had the requirement that B was positive. Well, here it is an ideal, so the sign makes no difference. But it was also the oddness. So what I want is that this ideal has the property that if I look at R modulo B, that is odd. This will always be a finite number as long as I avoid the zero ideal. So in this ring R modulo B, the number 2 is invertible. And then I also take an element A in R, and just as for the integers, I like A to be coprime to B, and that is to say that RA, the ideal generated by A, is coprime to B in the sense that together they generate the unit ideal. And that is equivalent to saying that this RA plus B contains the unit element, so that this element A, when I view it as an element in the residue class ring, the coset of A modulo B actually belongs to the unit group. So this last condition is equivalent to saying that A mod B belongs to the unit group of this finite commutative ring. It has an inverse modulo B. And then this A on B is defined in a perfectly similar way, but you do have to be a little careful. It is again either 1 or minus 1. And if B is a prime number, I say prime number, but I mean if it is a prime ideal, so that R mod B is a finite field, then it should be congruent to A to the power half the number of units of the residue class field. So that is modulo B, and that will be modulo B plus 1 or minus 1 for the same reason as before. So this is if B is prime, and then in general, for general B, this A on B is a product of the prime ideals, and these are the prime ideals of with R mod P all. So those are the prime ideals of which the residue characteristic is greater than 2. This symbol is a W, it stands for with. And then I have here A mod P. And then I have to face a slight problem, because here I have to write, if I want to imitate the situation of the integers, I have to write here the number of factors P in B. And if R is a maximal order, then you have unique factorization into prime ideals, and then that makes perfect sense. But in general, I have to define what I mean by this exponent, LPB, that is the P length of B. And let me tell you how this P length can be defined so as to generalize the situation of the full ring of integers. And that is done by writing down a sequence of ideals, B0, B1, until, let's say, Bt, which is B. And these ideals, they should be a chain pairwise different, so strictly descending, but it should not be possible to refine it. So that means that there is never any ideal in between two successive BIs. So what I am effectively doing here is that I write down a composition series for the R module R modulo B. And then if you look at one of these successive quotients, BI minus 1 modulo BI, then that will be a simple module over R. It has exactly two submodules, the zero module and the whole thing, because otherwise there would be something intermediate in my chain. So that means that for each I, there will be a prime ideal, P, a maximal ideal, such that SR modules BI minus 1 modulo BI is isomorphic to R mod P. I should have said there is a P, a unique P, that, which is the annihilator of the quotient, such that this module is isomorphic to R mod P, and then LP of B is the number of I for which this, let's call this P, PI, for which P is PI. So that is the number of times that P occurs in this chain. And that clearly generalizes the multiplicity of P and B in case my R is indeed a Dedekind domain. And you also see that if B is prime, then the P length of B, if P is equal to B, is equal to 1. And all for all other P, that P length will be 0. So this clearly generalizes the Jacobi symbol that I defined for Z. And now the question is, can we determine this symbol in polynomial time? And the answer is yes. So let me write down the theorem here. There is a polynomial time algorithm, PTA, that means polynomial time algorithm, that with input, well, the input is just all you need for making the symbol meaningful. So first you input R, and inputting R, that means that you input R as an abelian group, as I explained yesterday. And it is just a free abelian group, so you just have to specify the rank. And secondly, you have to specify the multiplication, which is a map from R tensor R to R, which you can specify in the way I explained yesterday, in the way you specify in general morphisms between finitely generated abelian groups. And with B it is the same. B is an ideal, and you simply specify it as an additive subgroup of R, and you are doing that only for the case that B is actually an ideal. So, and satisfying my conditions, non-zero, and an odd index, and also A, all of these as before, computes the symbol A on B. And we have to do this while avoiding the problems that I pointed out, the fact that the reciprocity law is less than ideal, and the fact that there is no Euclidean algorithm. And that is one of the things that you encounter more often in algorithmic algebraic number theory, that you run into a perfectly natural question, in this case, computing a symbol that plays a role, for example, in class field theory, but all of the theorems of class field theory are not enough to provide a polynomial time algorithm. And what you have to do here is to develop your own theorems in order to make this possible. And those theorems I will next proceed to formulate. And those theorems, they are about another symbol, and that is a symbol that is defined in the following situation. Suppose that B is a finite abelian group. FAG means finite abelian group. And in the application to this algorithm, that is going to be the additive group of R modulo B, different type form B. And my beta, that is the second thing that you need to know, that is an automorphism of B. And that automorphism, well, if I have this abelian group R mod B, then it is actually a ring, and A is a unit in there, and multiplication by that unit gives you an additive automorphism of R mod B. That is the way you have to think of beta. And then we have a beta comma B that is a symbol that, not surprisingly, generalizes the Jacobi symbol. It takes values in one and in minus one, and it is defined to be the sign of the of beta viewed as a permutation of the underlying set of B. So in other words, we have this automorphism group of B. It consists of permutations of the underlying set. So it lies in the symmetric group of B, which has order n factorial, if n is the order of B. And then you have the sign map from elementary algebra. And if you compose this, these two maps, the inclusion and the sign map, then you get this symbol beta B, which already shows that if you fix capital B, then this is multiplicative in beta, as was the case for the Jacobi symbol, which I didn't point out. But if I fix my B, then this function of A is really a group homomorphism from the unit group of R mod B to plus or minus one. Okay, so that is the sign. And then we have two other theorems. If this is theorem one, then we have theorem two, which is the one that I suggested already, that this A mod B, that you get it as this symbol. So here you have the automorphism of the additive group of R mod B, which is given by multiplication by A. And here you have, let's write it RB plus. RB plus is just the additive group of R mod B. And if you compute this sign in that situation, then the theorem asserts that what you get is the Jacobi symbol. That is theorem two, and I will suggest much of the proof in the present lecture. And then we have another theorem, and that is the following. There is a polynomial time algorithm with input B and beta, and B is specified to the algorithm in the way I explained yesterday with generators and relations, and beta likewise, you just told what beta does to the generator, and the output is, of course, the output is my symbol. And if you combine these two theorems, then you immediately see that my first theorem follows, because this finite abelian group is easy to compute. It is a co-kernel of the inclusion map from B and R, and also this map is easy to compute because we know how to do multiplication in R. So these are the two theorems that I want to sketch the proof of in this lecture, and then our problem will be solved so that I can use this part of the blackboard for other purposes. Yeah, it turns out that it is best first to prove theorem three, in the sense that if you have enough material for doing that, then the proof of theorem two drops out almost immediately. And in fact, you can say that both of these theorems ultimately follow from one important lemma. Let me make one remark about this, however. Since I should admit that I am not going to prove the entire theorem, I am going to prove only the half that is of interest to us. Namely, we will assume in the proof and in the algorithm that the cardinality of B is odd. The cardinality of B, that is a finite integer, positive, so it is either odd or even. In our application, it is always odd. And therefore, I will restrict what I have to say about theorem three to the case of finite abelian groups of odd order. The theorem is also true when B has even order, but then the algorithm is completely different. Actually, it's fair to say that it is easier, but it is of no interest to the Jacobi symbol, and you can find the details of the case that B is even, the cardinality of B is even, in the lecture notes, maybe just in the exercises. So here's the main lemma. So suppose that I have a short exact sequence of finite abelian groups, a short exact sequence of finite abelian groups of odd order. And suppose that I have three automorphisms, one for each of these groups. So an alpha, beta, gamma are automorphisms of A, B, and C, respectively, such that they are compatible with each other, which means that this diagram that I am drawing in which I repeat my original sequence once, and here I have those alpha, beta, and gamma, such that this diagram is commutative. So that is really equivalent to saying that I have an automorphism beta of B, as I had it before, and it should be such that A, when I view it as a subgroup of B, is exactly mapped to itself, and that will then induce a unique map from C to itself, which will automatically be an automorphism as well. And then the lemma states that this symbol that we are talking about is multiplicative in such exact sequences. And that is the key both to what we need to prove to get a good algorithm and to the fact that theorem 2 is valid. This lemma is completely wrong without a hypothesis that the groups are of all order. Then there will be different lemmas that are valid, but there is not in all cases a situation that you can express the middle sign in terms of the other data. Okay, so let me give you at least a sketch of the proof of this lemma. Because it is central to everything that I will have to say. And let me draw a picture of my group. Here I have my group B. And here I have C. Here's B, and there is C. And here we have the unit element of C. And the kernel, that is this group that is lying here. Maybe I should find some color here. So that is the group A. That is a subgroup of B. And what I do for the purposes of my proof is that I pick a section. So for each element of C, I pick one element in the fiber above it. But you have to keep in mind that this is only a set theoretic section. And the image, well, the image is this piece. So this is S of C. And if you want to lift this element, you end up there. S of this element is the one over there. So that is good for us, because now I get a coordinate system on my group B. For every B in B, I can pick two coordinates in a unique way, a coordinate little a in capital A and little c in capital C. And the property should be that B is, let's say, S of C plus little a. Yeah, so if B lies here, then you map it down to C, then this SC is lying above it in the lower row, and then A will be here. So B is the sum. And if you add two B's, then you have to add two of those SC's, which is a disaster, because S is not a group homomorphism. But now what I do is I look at three maps from B to itself, three permutations. And the first one sends this element of B, which I write in my two coordinates, I just apply my automorphism to A. So it goes to S of C plus, yeah, I have this automorphism, beta, I apply it to A, so that's the same as applying alpha. So that is alpha of A. that is not quite what beta is doing, because I have not been touching S of C. And my second map, it does touch S of C and it leaves the A alone. And how does it touch S of C? Well, I apply my automorphism at the bottom. So I apply gamma, it's called gamma to C, and then I take a section and then I add A itself. The A is left alone and I have here this gamma of C. And it is clear, so what is happening in the picture is that the first map is just on this first column on A is just alpha, and on each of the other columns it is also alpha if you just translate it. So this is just as a permutation, it is just as many copies of alpha as there are elements in C. So this is a permutation, and the sign that is the sign of alpha raised to the power the order of C, because I repeat that permutation once for every fiber. But C is odd, so I can cross it out. And likewise, this permutation is just what gamma does in every row. So the sign here, that is the sign of gamma C raised to the power the cardinality of A, but A has also an order. So rather than crossing it out, I don't even write it down. If you now compose these maps, you first do the first and then you do the second, then you do not quite get your beta. But it turns out that what you do get is something that lies in the right fiber and that differs from beta simply by a translation. So the last map, it sends SC plus A, and now I get my piece of paper, because this is a very complicated computation and I don't want to make a mistake. So I take beta and I apply it to the S of gamma inverse C. That is what is happening. And then I still add A. So this gamma inverse C that lies somewhere in C, if I apply S to it, then I lift it so that this is an element of B that maps to gamma inverse C. If I apply beta to it, then I get C again. So this actually lies in the fiber over C. So this lies in the fiber over C. So that means that what you are doing with this permutation is that in each fiber, you translate by the difference between these two elements. So in the fiber over C, this is translation by an element of A, namely this element minus that element. If I give this element the name star, then it is by star minus S of C. And I don't really care which element it is, but it is an element of A. And you see A is a group of odd order. So this element by which I translate has odd order. So in each fiber, this is a permutation of odd order. And permutations of odd order, they are even. So this is an even permutation. And for the purposes of computing science, it is completely irrelevant. And then you sit down, as I have been doing this afternoon, and then you discover that if you apply these maps one after the other, first the top one, next the middle one, then the bottom one, that the composed map is exactly the same as beta. That is something that anybody can check for himself, and I did it 3 times, so I'm pretty sure it is true. So the sign of this permutation, beta, is the product of the signs. This one is even, so that gives me exactly what I wanted to prove. So that is at least a sketch of the proof of my main lemma. Okay, this work of art has to be sacrificed, however, since we are now going to use this lemma to, well, let's first prove this theorem 2. So here's the proof of theorem 2, which states that alpha on B is the sign, this is A on B, sorry, sign of multiplication by A on this ring R mod B. And if B is prime, if B is a prime ideal, then this R mod B is a finite field. And if it has a unit group that A belongs to, A mod B belongs to the unit group, and the unit group of a finite field is cyclic. So let's suppose for the moment that A generates that unit group. So A mod B generates the multiplicative group of that field, which is the entire field without the zero. And if I write now all elements here as powers of A, then you see that the map multiplication by A is one long cycle of length, the cardinality of this group, which is the order of A, and one cycle, which is just the zero. So in this situation, you can easily compute the sign of the map, because B has odd norm, so this group has even order. There's an element of order 2 in there, minus 1. So it is a cycle of even length, and therefore it is odd, and therefore this multiplication by A is minus 1. And if A is a generator mod B, then it is certainly not a square mod B, so that is also A on B. So in that special case that B is prime and A generates the group, we have a perfectly straightforward proof of theorem 2. And if I now replace my A by powers, well, both of them are, for fixed B, are group homomorphisms as a function of A. And if two group homomorphisms agree on a generator of the group they are defined on, then they will be equal. So that means that the case that B is prime, we prove it. And in the general case, well, we go to our composition series, and you see that you have B0, B1, B2, and you end up with BT, which is B. And each of these quotients as an R module is isomorphic to R modulo some prime PI, as we saw before, and that is an isomorphism of R modules. So that means that this isomorphism carries multiplication by A to multiplication by A. and therefore multiplication by A on this quotient has a sign, so x goes to AX on this group BI minus 1 mod BI, that will be the same as what happens on the right-hand side, which is, as we just proved, my Legendre symbol A on PI. And now you simply apply the main lemma about T times. If you know what the sign is in the first layer and in the second layer, then you combine it in the combined two layers and you keep going. And if you apply at every step this main lemma, so in the first case, B1 mod B2 will be my capital A, B0 mod B2 will be my capital B, and B0 modulo B1 will be my capital C. And then you keep going and you discover that the sign of X goes to AX on the entire quotient is simply the product over I of these Legendre symbols, and that is by definition, so it means that this thing here, X goes to AXRB, is the product over I of A of PI, and that is by definition simply our Jacobian. So that is the proof of theorem two. So all these Jacobi symbols are ultimately no more than signs of permutations. It is shocking how much structure one can throw away here. These permutations, the proof also made use of permutations that were not group automorphisms at all. So we are really making use of the freedom that we have here. Okay, now this main lemma is also going to be used in the proof of theorem three. And theorem three is in a sense not really a theorem, it is an algorithm. It asserts the existence of an algorithm, and the algorithm computes the beta B when B and beta are given as input to the algorithm in the manner that I explained yesterday. And that makes use of another lemma, which follows from the main lemma, and that is the following lemma. So suppose that I have two integers t and n, which are t is non-negative and n is positive. Then what I will do in this lemma is that I will look at a particularly beautiful B, namely a B that is of exponent n, it's killed by n, so that is a module over Z mod n Z, and it will be a free module of rank T. So then for B equal to Z mod n Z to the power T, and this power T that is supposed to be a repeated direct sum, so if n is a prime number, then this will be a vector space over Z mod n Z of dimension T. One has, well, for all beta in the automorphism group of B, there is an expression for the sign, and it goes as follows. If you have an endomorphism, it also true for endomorphism, not just automorphisms. If you have an endomorphism of a free module over a commutative ring, then that endomorphism has a determinant, and that is a multiplicative function of the endomorphism. If you compose two endomorphisms, then the determinants multiply. And that determinant that lies in Z mod n. And if beta is an automorphism, then this will be a unit modulo n, because beta has an inverse, and the determinant of the inverse is the inverse of the determinant. So this is a number mod n, and the statement is that all you have to do to compute the sign is that you take the Jacobi symbol of the determinant over n. And there you see that while previously we were determining Jacobi symbols through signs, we are now computing signs through Jacobi symbols. But there is an important difference. This is not the generalized Jacobi symbol. This is just the plain classical Jacobi symbol that I started with my lecture with, just for integers. So if you believe this lemma, then at least for simple-minded groups of this sort, you have reduced the computation of the sign to the computation, first of all, of the determinant, which is somewhere, I believe, in the notes, in an exercise, I would guess. And secondly, the computation of the Jacobi symbol for Z, and that is what I told you at the beginning, how you do it with a Euclidean algorithm and the reciprocity law. And the determinant in my case is actually in Z mod n Z star. So so let me briefly indicate how you prove this. First of all, you filter this group using the divisors of n, and that filtration you attack with the main lemma, and you discover that if you want to prove this, then by the main lemma, it reduces immediately to the case that n is a prime number, an odd prime number. Oh, I forgot to say that n was odd. And if n is a prime number, well, then you like to filter your vector space with a set of invariant subspaces so that you can again apply the main lemma. But not every automorphism allows such a filtration, but it is very easy to see that the betas which do allow such a filtration generate the group so that this formula follows without any further ado. So let me take this lemma for granted. And what you now do in general is that you apply a theorem from last time to write your group as the direct sum of cyclic groups with the property that these numbers, these orders of these cyclic groups, divide each other in succession. And if you then look at B modulo NMB, and you do that also for the others, so here you have a filtration of the group. N1 is the exponent of the group, so this is zero. Then you will see that each of the successive quotients is acted upon by my beta, my automorphism, and each of the quotients will be free of a certain rank. Here the rank is m, there is m minus 1, m minus 2, it goes down to 1, over a ring of which the order z mod n z is, all here is nm, here is the quotient of the two successive n's, and the last one is n1 divided by n2. So you see that you can use this lemma to roll up the entire group and multiply the signs so as to get the algorithm that theorem 3 alludes to. So that proves the theorem that I mentioned at the beginning. It is certainly not the end of the story, since if you know a little more algebraic number theory, then you will know that there are also higher power residue symbols. And you might wonder what is happening, because there are no higher signs on symmetric groups. Well, that is true, and nevertheless, the whole thing generalizes. And one way to find out what you have to do there is just sign up for the summer school next year. Chances are that I will tell you how to do it, and maybe you can even figure it out yourself. In the meantime, you have a whole year for it. I thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Hendrik, for that wonderful lecture. Are there questions? Well, Hendrik, I was going to ask about the power residue symbols, but you say I have to wait till next year, so I'll wait till next year.
Okay, sure. Well, we can maybe communicate in private about this. Don't give it away.
Okay, I don't see any questions, so let's thank Hendrik for all of his lectures this week.
It was a great pleasure.